the name suggests, drags a net. Now, T-R-A-W-L is for trawling a net, and you can also trawl a line, but these are trawlers, you know, because they trawl nets, and it happens at the back generally, because the first trawlers that came about were the stern trawlers, which drag the net from the back. Sorry, Gabriella. I definitely think that...
Aaron, could you repeat the question, please?
Yeah, so Gabriella is asking whether, you know, because fisheries is in such a state, whether we should look at aquaculture, sustainable aquaculture as a good option. Okay, and the answer is definitely yes. We have to look at ways of farming fish sustainably. But the current trajectory in which it's happening, and as you probably know as well, is definitely unsustainable and probably even worse than this way of feeding wild-caught fish. The feed conversion ratios are terrible, like they're doing sea bass farming in the south, and your conversion ratio, your sea bass is your tsona, your bait key. You know, for every kilo that you produce, you're feeding two and a half kilos of wild caught fish. So it doesn't make any sense, you know, and it's wild caught thrash, and it's generally not this trawl thrash, but it's exclusive sardine fisheries dedicated to catch, to bulk fish. Okay, and the answer is yes, and you have examples of very good aquaculture, which is, you know, very strongly mangrove-dependent, extensive aquaculture is what it's called. But typically what we've seen in India is intensive aquaculture, primarily done for prawn farming, is very intensive. Per hectare of land, there's a heavy input of antibiotics, pesticides, and you have to clear mangrove areas. And because of that, there's a lot of flushing out, which also creates dead zones. Mm-hmm. And now, as I was telling, I think I was telling you, Annie, you know, when you're sitting down here, that the shrimp, the big white shrimp you see in the markets, they're almost sort of pale gray, they're not even white. That's not even an Indian species. It's a species that's come from the Pacific. It's called the Pacific white-leg shrimp. You know, and I don't even know why we're farming that. And the thing is, it's a dominant form. It doesn't even taste good. You know, I mean, if you're making a prawn curry with a Pacific white-leg versus a wild-caught shrimp, it's definitely having a wild-caught shrimp. And looking at the form of fisheries that's being done, you know. But I think, basically, you know, anyway, I'll sort of stop at that. Did I answer your question?
Yeah. I know you want it to be a discussion, but from your point of view as an expert, what do you think needs to be done?
I look at it as many solutions. I mean, one thing is things like reduction fisheries and all definitely have to go, because you will always make you'll always make better with another alternative. Okay. The second thing, when it comes to personal choices, okay, we can generally make a difference. But if you see a typical restaurant menu, okay, you're seeing 3, 4, 5 species at the most, or maybe 6, okay? Many of the species are either shrimp or they are species high up on the food chain. They're kind of like the tigers of the sea, you know? So you remove those fish and you have a much larger impact on the ocean than if you remove something at the bottom of the food web. And if you look at typical Goan families or families along the coast, we have, there is a general preference among coastal communities for smaller fish for a long period of time. And that was that boiled down to cost and other things, and also you could get much more. And but besides which, a lot of these smaller fish are a lot healthier for you to eat, because there's this whole idea of biomagnification, wherein if you're a predator higher up on the food web, you know, the toxins also magnify as you go up. Like the tunas are generally much you know, unhealthier for you to eat as compared to, say, a sardine. So you should preferably eat the you know, low down the food web. I think, like Gabriella was asking about, you know, good examples of fisheries, we need to flag good practices. And like, you know, in our backyard, we have some really good practices. It's not about stopping fishing or not eating seafood. I don't think that's the answer. Because if you don't eat seafood and if you're a non-vegetarian, I would bloody well go and eat other meat, which probably has a bigger food footprint. And so far in the oceans, there has not been a single fish extinction that I'm aware of or published in the literature. There have been tons of land extinctions because of agricultural change, because of, you know, clear felling in the US, clear felling prairies. In the last year, we've had so many extinctions. You know, but in the oceans, one thing is we're not, you know, we're not really aware of it, but there is no reported fish extinction.
Aaron, I'm just curious to know how this debate ties in with the debate of the 60s and 70s in Goa.
Yeah.
You know, when the fisheries issue was not led by environmentalists, not raised by environmentalists, but by fishermen.
Yeah.
And in those days, trawling was just introduced. So, you know, there was total chaos here. And fishermen managed to get information from Norway, Scandinavia, which were sending the trawlers, which were sending the technology. And actually, it was quite a scandal, but because the press was not so open in those times and all, nothing much came out. Okay, so you know, how does this tie up with that? There is a whole lot of information documentation of that era which is not published, which is known only to a small circle of friends, including, you know, Ramonkar readers like the late Matani Saldana and things like that. But you know, I think it was such a big scandal then, the way politicians got loans to buy trawlers, the way the state subsidized the full kind of operations, you know. And finally, it went back into, you know, the argument then was that it would increase the nutritional intake of people, but I don't think any such thing happened.
So that's the exact point, basically, and I'm glad you raised it because I've not spoken much about the history of trawl fishing in India. So trawl fishing, the first trawlers were introduced as part of the Indo-Norwegian project in the state of Kerala in 1956. Okay, and then they were, at the beginning, no fisherman really wanted to get into trawling. It was something new. These big vessels were sort of monstrosities as far as they were concerned. They were scared about operating them. You know, they didn't know, they didn't want to touch it. So if you look at the history of trawling, a lot of the people who got into the trawl sector included businessmen. In Tamil Nadu, there were actors like, you know, MGR. Well, he had like 7 or 8 trawlers at that point of time. And there were lots of films about fishermen and, you know, fisher rights movements, etc. But the thing is, the trawlers, they had no, there was no sort of zoning at that point of time. You know, the trawlers could go wherever they want and fish, and they were reaping in the profits very soon. In Goa, it started around the late 1960s, 70s. You had 1, 2, 3 trawlers, and then it slowly started increasing, as you could see the profits being made. Many of them were not from the fishing sector, and the artisan or the small-scale fishermen who jumped onto the fishing sector also made bucks and didn't want to get out of it. But obviously, that saw a lot of agitations, because lots of that fish, which is of no value to the trawlers, because they were primarily targeting shrimp at that point of time. It was called the pink gold rush because they're targeting shrimp at that point of time. The rest of it was really important to the artisan who used passive gear primarily, you know. But even among the small scale sector, we had shades of gray. They were not all shrinking violets. We got to recognize that the small scale fishery is a very, I mean, they contribute, you know, in terms of numbers, way more. They support a larger number of people. But at the same time, they had to sort of modify their gear. They had to, you know, many of them modified themselves to such an extent that in Kerala, there are these long boats called the Tangavalams, you know, which are really long. They're about, 52 feet. And what they've done is they've just chopped it in the center, put an outrigger, and because they're considered artisans, they are allowed to trawl in really shallow water. So they're trawling in like 5 feet of water where you can actually sort of swim up to them and, you know, buy a bunch of shrimp and come back if there is any shrimp now. But so they kept modifying. So what I'm saying is, fisheries, especially trawling, is very capitalist in its nature. It's also one that is purely profit-driven. Fishing is profit-driven. It's not driven by, you know, species or, you know, love for any particular group. It's purely profit-driven. So when one species declines, fishermen modify by catching another species. And this is something that we have the luxury of doing in a multi-species fishery like in India. Like if you went to the Grand Banks or to Newfoundland, once cod stopped, it just killed an entire fishing industry because there's nothing else to kind of fall back on. You know, the capelin and all were further inshore, which were caught by other fishermen. But over here, you had the choice of playing with other stuff. Since trawling started in the 1950s, the area of fish has expanded like about 4.5 times, but it's shrunk back. So all these guys have been going to distant waters, and now because it's no longer cost effective, they're coming back to catch thrash fish. So fishermen will modify, you know, change gear, they'll fish longer hours, you know, just to make ends meet, basically. They'll do, I mean, you will have to do, if that's your business, you'll do anything, you know. And so that's one way that these guys sort of adapted, changed. I hope I've answered that question of yours broadly. Yeah.
So Alan, are there any restrictions to trawling
in India? Yeah, so we've got the works on paper, yeah, but it's almost impossible to enforce, and I don't think we should ever get into something like that because there's lots of stuff on mesh size restrictions. You cannot use a net, but you know which fisher monitor goes out to sea to kind of enforce the mesh. These fishermen are so good; they can change their code end at will. They change like some of the trawlers in Betul. They have like about so a trawler approximately needs about 3 to 6 people, but a gill netter, which are these huge nets that they put out at sea that go up to 8 kilometers. For kingfish and other fish, they need about 20 people, okay? So there's a lot of restrictions, but these guys can change gear at will. So I think the devil here is controlling number of trawlers and not really tackling gear. We've also got another restriction, which is your Marine Fisheries Regulation Act in every state, okay, which is a space closure. When trawlers are not allowed up to three nautical miles, it's reserved for the artisan, okay? And it's present in every state of the country. And we've also got the closed season, which is for 2 months now. No, it's in every, now it's uniform along the West Coast, which is great. But the thing is also, fish is right now such a globalized, such a global market, that if I don't have my Bangladesh here, in the monsoons, yeah, people are crying, no fish in the market, you know, we need, you know, I wish, and you know, the department has sorted it out, because they're getting you Bangladesh from the East Coast. So you're never without your mackerel curry rice. You can get fish any point of time of the year. And so your footprint hasn't really changed, you know. In the earlier days with the artisans, they followed very strict sort of seasons, this and that. Now they don't play according to that. They also play, they go wild in the sea, you know. They change nets, they do all kinds of things. And it's very difficult to have a control or a handle on the small scale sector. Even though I would say that they have had a much better internal control amongst themselves, you know, than our outside policing. But they have had to resort to various measures to keep afloat.
I have a question. Among all the seas and oceans that I have seen, I don't see any fishing or much fishing happening in the Mediterranean and the Black Sea. The locals, they say that the fish has been overfished and, you know, all fish is gone.
Yeah. It's heavily depleted, yeah. It's heavily depleted. Lots of dead zones. The Black Sea is, yeah. It's, you just have like a couple of, you know, tiny tiddlers now that they sort of fish for clupids, you know. Lots of their sardines. But you know what's happening now? You know, sardines, which are a fish that actually, you know, so in the fish market, like, you know, people keep asking me, Aaron, why are you complaining? There's always fish in the market. We've got fresh fish. We've got a good price. And the thing is, one thing is the fish that you see in Mali or in Shapura, in Shapura it does reflect, you know, the waters around, but in Mali it does not. Those fishing boats are fishing as far as Gujarat, the Gulf of Kambat, the Gulf of Kutch, that area off the Junagadh coast. So what you're catching is like off the coast of Dapoli could be from anywhere, you know. So what you see on your fish landing site does not reflect fresh go and catch. It's as old as 7 days when you get it, and by the time it reaches the, so it's hit about 10 days. You're eating 10 days fresh fish, basically. That's, you know, that's how you're getting it.
But at Shapura,
that's better, yeah.
So, and Lepo then is a better fish to eat in
Shapura? Lepo is lower down in the food web, but it's also only trawled. You can't catch Lepo and other, it's, especially the small ones, they're purely trawled. So the thing is, the answer is, I don't think you should stop eating fish, but I think if you, yeah, but there's, I mean, I don't think anyone should stop eating fish, because I said there's always, and you know, impact to your transfer, but I think if you have the option of, you know, of knowing the fisherman that you're getting fish.